Barbie Harden Hall, and she is running against Daniel Webster. Before I start, I want to say how grateful I am to be here with all of you. And I want to say and ask if I can have a little bit of grace, because this is not something that I am used to. This is not something I've ever done before. It's quite literally my first experience like this. So I hope to do okay. I started off my campaign announcement to my family and friends by saying that this was the most insane thing that I've ever done. And no matter how amazing and how necessary public service is, I do think in the current political landscape, you have to be a little bit crazy to willingly get into all of this. But I want to tell you a little bit more about myself. Sorry, am I doing this wrong? How a mom decides to run for Congress, a little bit about my story and what kind of got me to this point. I want to touch a little bit about my campaign platform, the things that I want to fight for. And I do understand that a lot of you in this room probably know a lot more than I do. I'm always willing to admit the things that I don't know, but I'm one of those people that I will know it by the end of the day. And I also want to talk a little bit about our current leader in District 11, Barbie Webster, and how we can actually flip this seat. So I want to start off by flip it blue. So don't judge me yet. I like to tell people that I am a recovering Republican. These are a little bit of my past pictures here. I grew up here in Mount Doran, Eustace, and in an environment that I would probably qualify as the ultra MAGA crowd if it had existed back then. I went to a Christian school my entire life, grew up in church, grew up around people who were very religious, but when it came to politics, are very much like they are today. A little bit contradictory. So I'm a little ashamed that it took me so long to get to the point that I am now. And unfortunately, fate passed myself in my own life and the things that mattered to me to actually consider the experiences of other people. And outside of the sheltered life I was really accustomed to. It took me far too long to broaden my mind, but I am actually really glad I got to this place. In 2016, I can't tell you if it was because I became a mother that year, or simply because of Donald Trump, or because of both, but that was really when I kind of woke up to thinking outside of myself, my experiences. I had somebody else to care about, to think about their future, to think about their life, and I did not like what was going on. And I did not vote for Donald Trump, so. But that would be that year, 2016, what would officially push me towards becoming a Democrat. I'm proud I reached that point, even though it took me probably a little bit longer than it should have. I want to talk a little bit about the unique experience myself and my family has gone through. I imagine that some people hear my story and how it drove me to get to this point to decide to run for Congress. And they get a little confused thinking it's the only issue I care about, the only thing I would focus on. But I just want to make clear to everybody that just because this is kind of the catalyst that got me to this point, it's not the only thing that's driving me. It's not the only thing I care about. But my unique experience is one that helps me be empathetic to the experience of others that make it to a point where you reach out to a member of Congress for a little bit of help. So our daughter, okay. So our daughter Isley was born in 2016. Oh, Reese, our second daughter, was born in 2017. Everett would be the third picture. He was born in 2019. Wow. Brady, my last, was 2021. So these are my babies. In March 2021, I was about 7 months pregnant with our son Brady when our one-year-old son Everett would suddenly stop walking. Although we had raised concerns to our pediatrician for the 6 months prior to that, our concerns were kind of waved off about his walking progression until he actually could no longer walk. We began the process of searching for a reason and a diagnosis, seeing neurologists, physical therapists, speech therapists, occupational therapists, orthopedic doctors, a cardiologist, a geneticist. During those months that we searched for a diagnosis, Evan improved with therapy and was getting stronger, learning to walk again, or learning to talk and getting better and stronger at walking. In November 2021, our geneticist at Arnold Palmer would give us the devastating news that whole genome genetic testing revealed that Everett had metachromatic leukodystrophy, or MLD. MLD is a rare genetic disease that has no cure and would result in his death, best case scenario, within 5 years. My husband and I both happened to be carriers. We never knew it, and nobody in our family knew it. And because we both held that defective gene, our children would have a 25% chance of having MLD, a 25% chance of not being affected, and a 50% chance of being a carrier as well. We also faced having to find out that our other three children would have to be tested as well to see if they also had MLD and would have the same diagnosis. We had a wonderful geneticist. She reached out to help us find somebody that could help us. We would learn in the coming days that gene therapy treatment, which was a life-saving treatment, had been approved overseas, that children overseas were getting this treatment, that their lives were being saved, but that it had not even been approved for a clinical trial here in the United States. We would have to travel to Italy if we were approved for treatment, and we were told that it would probably be an out-of-pocket cost of around $1 million, asking if we would be willing to do that. And of course we said yes, we would do whatever it took to get to that point. Unfortunately, Everett was not approved for gene therapy treatment because he could no longer independently walk at this point. MLD is a progressive genetic disorder that affects the central nervous system. I'm not gonna get a lot into it because it's a little complicated, but there's a myelin sheath that protects your nerves and that's not there. So the nerves slowly degenerate. Results in progressive degeneration, which means first they lose ability to walk, to talk, to eat, to swallow, to smile, to move. So basically they lose everything until they lose everything. So we are facing the reality of going through that process and having to see it happen. Okay, I'm gonna show you a few slides because this will show you that these children are born completely normal. You have absolutely no idea that anything is going on until symptoms start to start, and then what continues to happen. The only hope is to catch MLD and other genetic conditions early enough to qualify for life-saving treatment. These children are born completely normal, healthy children with no noticeable signs that a devastating diagnosis is only months or years away. And once those symptoms begin, it is often too late to qualify for treatment that will save lives. Instead, they must go from normal lives to slowly losing their ability of the most basic movements and functions. I was not paying attention. Can you go back one more? Yes. One more. To the beginning of that one, yeah. We would travel to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania within 3 weeks of diagnosis to meet with the experts at UPMC, Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh. Everett would be approved for a bone marrow transplant using a donor cord blood. This would be the best case scenario for this treatment would be that it would slow the progression of the disease to give us more time. We would also learn that thankfully our other three children would not have MLD, but would be carriers like my husband and I. We made the decision to move forward with the bone marrow transplant, leaving our two daughters here at home with their grandparents. And us and our son Brady, who was still breastfeeding at the time, would live in the hospital in the Ronald McDonald House in Pittsburgh while Everett received treatment. And that's the day you got his transplant right there. We were hoping to be discharged from the hospital in March, remaining in Pittsburgh until his immune system was safe enough to travel home, likely towards the end of May. The transplant seemed to be successful. The enzyme that he was missing was showing up. We were so hopeful it was going to be a success. Unfortunately, cytomegalovirus caused complications and issue after issue, providing us numerous hurdles and problems. Our boy began deteriorating before our eyes and would pass away on May 20th, 2022 at the age of 2. It was heartbreaking to go from expecting hopefully another 3 to 5 years with him to being gone 6 months after diagnosis. Fortunately, he was saved from the slow, painful experience of gradually declining, losing his ability to sit up, talk, play, eat, smile, and move. Sorry. This is one reason why, in addition for advocating for gene therapy treatment, I also work with MLD and rare disease communities to advocate for newborn screening. Can you just go back one more? The conditions tested at birth are determined by each state, with many following the recommended uniform screening panel that is determined by the Secretary of State, the Secretary of the Department of Human and Health Services. So it's a test that's already done, and it can find conditions like MLD. It's just not tested right now. Personally, it's unconscionable that conditions are currently not included that have the capability to be identified, tested for, and life-saving treatments available, and they're not being done. So this tells me every year over 100,000 newborns could be saved from death or life-altering illnesses if proper screening was to take place. Okay. It would take us some time to reach the point where our grief allowed us to begin the advocating process. I did learn about the Every Life Foundation for Rare Diseases and their advocacy work through the Rare Disease Legislative Advocates. Most people don't know, you hear a rare disease and you think that it's rare, but in actuality, there's approximately 30 million Americans that suffer from a rare disease. And the estimates are all over the place, but the national economic burden that rare diseases causes our country, some estimates say $2 trillion a year. Fortune Magazine says it's as high as between $7.2 trillion and $8.6 trillion a year. So it's a huge burden for our country, for the 30 million people in our country that are affected by it. So these communities help Americans living with rare diseases to advocate to our legislators and to our government to help in these areas. Our first event with them was Rare Diseases Week on Capitol Hill last year, an event attended by hundreds of people in Washington, D.C. from all over the United States. Okay. We attended Rare Diseases Day at the National Institute of Health, met with members of the Rare Disease Congressional Caucus, which is actually a bipartisan group that works for rare disease action in Congress, and Florida Representative Bill Arrakis from District 12 is actually one of the chairs on the committee. I was really excited to work and to meet with our legislators. I wanted to be able to put a face to the issue and show them that they have the power, that children are quite literally dying from preventable things, and they could help us get there. Because obviously, if they knew about it, they would do something, right? I would personally that day meet with members of Maxwell Frost's office, Representative Luna's office, Representative Waltz's office. We would also meet with the offices of Senator Marco Rubio and Senator Scott. I told them how newborn screening and gene therapy treatment could have saved our son's life, that gene therapy was still not approved in the United States, but it was in places like the European Union and the United Kingdom. That the FDA at that point was wanting blind placebo studies and clinical trials to take place before they would consider approving it, where children would have to die in order to get this treatment approved, even though it had already been proven and shown to be life-saving overseas. I wanted the FDA to consider MLD gene therapy treatment for priority review, and I discussed this with their offices. Daniel Webster's office didn't schedule the meeting, did not respond to his constituents wanting just a few minutes of his time or a member of the staff's time. There was another event at the end of the fall, Rare Across America, where we actually go to their district offices and discuss these same issues. Didn't schedule a meeting, didn't respond, nothing. We met with dozens of legislators that day, hundreds of us. He didn't even care to respond. It was amazing how eye-opening those meetings were for me and how truly disheartening. Those moments of realizing that in so many ways our system is built to fail. If they cannot care about enough about the lives of children and their health, what do they care about? What is going to force action? Unfortunately, it seems only those actions that provide some benefit to them, some airtime. And when I thought about it, I realized all the various ways that our system is set up to fail. How they stack the decks against us, the people that they feel are lower than them, are less than them, don't come from a specific background, don't have a certain bank account, or ones that they feel are undeserving. It's opened my eyes to all the moments that they have created a stockpile of issues that affect millions of lives, how they lit the fuse, how they watch everything burn, and then they try and say that they did everything they could to stop it. When you watch children die unnecessarily, families struggle with the financial burden and cost of receiving care and treatment, how they must beg for medical equipment and supplies, how they're denied treatment, then I can no longer stand aside and continue to watch it happen without doing something, without at least trying to do something. And that's kind of why I'm here. So let's talk about what I want to try and do. In no particular order, and this is not at all an exclusive list, but these are kind of the things I just wanted to touch on. Women's rights. I've heard so many family and friends tell me that they could never consider voting for a Democrat simply because of abortion. I was pro-life for basically my entire life. It's what I was taught, it was what I was raised on. You just don't do it. You just can't agree with it. But that does not mean at that point that I would ever prevent a woman from making the decision that is best for her life and her health. I do not want issues affecting myself, my family, to be decided by the government. And I think that is the way that we can reach a lot of these people who said that they would never vote for somebody simply because of abortion. If you don't agree with abortion, don't get one. But does it mean that a person has to go in front of a judge to beg for their life or to beg for their chance at life? It means that the government should have no say in what goes on in our lives. As you all saw, I had 4 children within 5 years, all of them C-sections. After my second, my doctors told me I had what was called a non-catastrophic uterine rupture. Non-catastrophic basically means that I didn't die. Just because I had gotten pregnant 5 months after my last C-section had not healed properly. My other pregnancies were high risk. I had to have babies by C-section at 36 weeks instead of the normal 40 weeks. And I was told that I would not survive another pregnancy, could not have any more children. It was too much of a risk for my life. My husband and I forgot to introduce him. This is my husband, Ryan. This is Carrie. She's from Germany. She's an exchange student that's staying with our family for the year. My husband and I, this is before we even knew about MLD or any issues regarding that, but simply to protect my life, went through the necessary procedures. I was already having a C-section. I had my tubes tied at the same time. When we found out that the chances of me still getting pregnant were still pretty high, you went and had a vasectomy. Thank you. But a lot of people don't get those opportunities. Don't get those opportunities because of the costs, because of the downtime of those procedures. So they need to be able to make these choices for their lives. I don't know if I could ever, if I were to accidentally get pregnant again, face having to tell my children, you may have to live without me, you may have to be raised without me because we did everything we could and it still happened. But that's not a decision that should be outside of my hands. It's not a decision that should be outside of my family's hands. Similarly, after my 4th pregnancy with Brady, 3 weeks after I began bleeding heavily, I went to the hospital and I was told that I would have to take a medication because they wanted to prevent me having to have a procedure because of the risk of infection so soon after my C-section. But it was a medication that was normally reserved for abortions. But by taking that medication, I avoided the risks of having to do an unnecessary procedure, and it worked. I just had to take some medicine. I got to go back home to my 3-week-old baby, and that was it. With our current laws, would I still be allowed to do that? Simply because it was a medication that is reserved for abortions? Would I again have to put my life at risk, the risk of infection, simply because I didn't have the ease of a pill to take? Again, another decision that should be up to me, my family, my doctors, and not up to the government. Okay, next, healthcare. How can we not seem to provide necessary medical care to our people? People are dying or they're living sick because they cannot afford the financial burden of getting care. Healthcare, our health, is not a privilege. It should not be a for-profit business. I've heard many people make comments about, is the price of gene therapy that would have treated my son worth the cost? It was cited as a reason as maybe it's not worth it. We're putting a price tag on people's lives. We're looking at the financials behind lives of children, lives of people, and that should not be the case. The treatment that our son received in January 2022 until his death in May 2022. Was about $4 million. Next slide. That's a screenshot of. And that was supposed to be just the beginning. Our insurance paid over $2 million for just those few months of treatment. We were going to be looking at, if it had worked, we were going to be looking at, hopefully, 5 years of treatment. And I mean medically complex treatment. Expensive treatment, but they want to say that one treatment, gene therapy, that was maybe $1 million, is not worth the cost. Gene therapy treatment means that they have this treatment and they go on to live basically normal lives. But is it worth the cost? Is that really what we've come to at this point? There are children in Florida on Medicaid that cannot get approved for treatment outside of state. They will not pay for treatment outside of the state, even when there are no doctors within the state that can treat them. We mentioned this to Senator Scott's office in a Zoom call this fall, and the response from his staffer was, "We're not going to get into that. We don't want to touch it." It's not part of his agenda, so it didn't matter. I have kids and friends with MLD. Their children cannot get approved from insurance for necessary equipment. I have children that are falling out of wheelchairs because they have no neck control, no trunk control, and their insurance companies will not approve them for specialized wheelchairs. So instead, their families just have to do what they can do to make them as comfortable as possible. And a lot of times, once a child dies, they donate the equipment to another, even though it's not a perfect fit, because that's the only option. How much money does our government pay for Medicare, for Medicaid, and tax breaks for employer-sponsored healthcare plans? How much do individuals and businesses pay for health insurance premiums? How much do we pay for out-of-pocket medical expenses? How much, and prescriptions? And we cannot afford it once you consider all of those things. How can every other country, major country in the world, afford it, and we can't? Aren't we the richest country in the world? With 100 million people in America holding medical debt that total upwards of $200 million, we have to do something. It's estimated that 41% of adults hold some kind of medical debt. Again, healthcare should not be a for-profit business. It is not a privilege, it is a right, and we should be providing it. Gun control. With a father that was a police officer and a hunter.
Sorry.
I grew up around guns and weapons my entire life. My husband and I, one of our very first dates was to go and shoot guns, and I actually outshot him. He denies it, but I have to prove somewhere. So my discomfort with guns really began around the birth of my second daughter, Reese, in 2017. This is a picture. I was in the abyss of postpartum depression and anxiety, and I would have visions and imagine what it would feel like to hold a gun to my head. I would just think about, I wonder what it would feel like to feel that barrel against my skin, the weight of it in my hands. And at that point, I didn't want guns anywhere near me. I didn't want them anywhere in the vicinity of myself or my family. And that was kind of where it started. Obviously, once you have kids and you see everything going on with school shootings, it only solidifies that anxiety around guns. When my four-year-old daughter was in kindergarten, or I'm sorry, when my first daughter was in pre-K, the first time she came home to me and told me about the active assailant drill they had, about how they had to go into a closet, my four-year-old, and hide in the closet and stay quiet from the bad man, it just broke my heart. And every time I got that call saying, oh, there was an active assailant drill today, it just devastated me. Last year, I was a chaperone for my daughter's kindergarten field trip. And I had to go, they told me to wait by the buses until after the announcements, and then the kids would come out to meet the buses and we'd get on the bus. One kindergarten class came out, we're just sitting there waiting, I'm waiting for my daughter's class, and the teacher comes up to me and she says, just so you know, they told us that we have to do a drill before we can get on the bus. the other class is going to wait till after the drill, and they're going to come. So the nearest classroom, once the drill goes off, they're going to run to the parking lot because they have the ability to hopefully outrun a gun. The kindergartners who would not be fast enough to outrun a gun would go into the classroom and hide in the closet. And she said, "You're going to come with us and you're going to hide in the closet." I immediately just, I knew I wasn't going to be able to face this experience. And of course, when the alarm goes off, the announcement comes, starting the drill, I see children running. I see the kindergartners, 5 and 6 year olds, running into a classroom. I follow them in, they all get into the closet, duck down, shh, be quiet. I turned and I walked away, and I walked to the bathroom of the classroom, and I just broke down. To see 5 and 6 year olds hiding in a closet, to imagine what the point we've come to, what have we come to? And I remember documenting the picture just because I'm like, I cannot forget this moment. I cannot forget the feelings of just a drill. And this has become normal. This is, I didn't do those things. This was, it was not something I've ever experienced in my life. Sorry. These are the school shootings statistics, which I know many of you are aware of. How have we gotten to the point where books and voting have more restrictions than weapons? How long can Republicans and gun lobbies ignore the national crisis that guns are fueling? How many people will have to die for us to get common sense gun policies? And these are from the shooting in Texas at the elementary schools. I do think the U.S. is starting to wake up a little more to this issue, but the message has become the Democrats are going to take all of your guns. Don't give up one thing or they're going to take everything. So I do think that this is one of the issues that you had said earlier that we have a messaging problem about. And this is not the end point to me, but this is a starting point. To me, this is where we have to start. I think we should have a federal background check system. I think that there should be mandatory licenses and waiting periods that are federally standard. Federal red flag laws, where judges have the ability to take away somebody's guns, take away somebody's access to guns. I believe we should be banning high capacity magazines. I think we also need to have mandatory safe storage laws. If you don't properly store your gun and it causes the injury or death of another, you're responsible. I also think there should be restrictions on made for combat weapons. I think that's usually the biggest sticking point. And I do believe that a lot of Americans agree with these. But to me, this is the starting point. This is what I want to work towards, and I think that we can get some support for this, a lot of support for this, nationally. Okay, education. I'm not going to get into all of it. But our school system is in decline. We're falling behind the world, and instead, we're banning books. We're banning the histories that are teaching our children the ways that we cannot repeat and go back on. And we just can't do it. What, Florida is the first state that's ever banned a dictionary or an encyclopedia, excuse me. A dictionary too, right? Okay, well, what point have we gotten to? It's misguided, and we've got to fix it. I personally know what happens when they try and hide the true history. My growing up in my Christian school, which I loved, but there's things that weren't touched on that I didn't learn later in life until I started going out and reading on my own, and it was shocking. Those are the things that we cannot be hiding. LGBTQ+. We have people that are choosing to end their lives because they cannot face their families, because they're repeatedly told by people on the right, by their families, by their churches, by the pundits that their families listen to, that the way they have felt their entire life is wrong, unnatural, that it's disgusting. No person should be silenced by hate. No person should be silenced by fear. These are the things that are important to me. The environment. Why is this even an issue? Why do we have to question the evidence? Florida is one of those areas that are most at risk. For Florida, we're going to continue to see devastating hurricanes, raging storm surges, property loss costing untold amounts of money, and a continuing property insurance crisis. I don't understand why this is an issue. And I know a lot of you agree with me. But it needs to be a huge focus for us, especially here in Florida. Sorry, do I still have you?
Yeah.
Okay. We're getting there. All right. Fair share. For too long, the rich, the ultra wealthy, and corporations have not been paying their fair share of taxes. Corporations to receive tax breaks in pursuit of a trickle-down economic system that just never materializes. They are getting richer while the low and middle classes continue to increasingly see the burden. Our government is also seeing the devastating effects of an unbalanced budget and mounting debt that will only continue to grow. You look at the Fortune 100 corporation list in 2021, it is easy to see the issue with the corporate tax code and the breaks that these profitable companies are receiving. Corporations with billions of dollars in profit are not only paying less than the corporate tax rate, some are paying zero in taxes, or even receiving refunds back from the government. Next slide, please. AT&T, $29.6 billion in earnings, no federal income taxes in 2021, and a refund of $1.2 billion. Charter Communications, which is Spectrum, $6 billion in earnings, no federal income taxes in 2021, and a refund of $12 million. AIG, $9.8 billion in earnings, no federal income tax in 2021, and a tax refund of $216 million. Dow, $1.5 billion in earnings, no federal income taxes in 2021, and a tax refund of $46 billion. $46 million. Even when you look outside the Fortune 100 list, companies with billions in earnings paid zero federal taxes. Salesforce, $2.7 billion in earnings. Duke Energy, $3.7 billion in earnings. Zero taxes. Netflix, $5.3 billion in earnings paid 1.1% tax rate. There should be a minimum standard tax rate for corporations and ultra wealthy. And I think we would see that we would get a lot of support from this, from most Americans who turned off Fox News. Protecting democracy. I don't think I have to go into this. We all know what's at stake. So that gets to the last section here. Where's Webster? Sorry, you can't really see that. What has been going on in District 11 since Daniel Webster was elected? This is a seasoned politician. He served in the Florida House of Representatives since 1980. He was eventually transferring to the Florida Senate. He decided to run for Congress in 2010, where he has been since then. So what has he accomplished in 11 years? In the 2023 legislative session, he introduced the fewest bills compared to the Florida delegation, only 4 bills or resolutions. He co-sponsored the fewest bills compared to the Florida delegation. He's in the 3rd percentile for all representatives serving 10 plus years. He got the 2nd fewest co-sponsors on bills compared to the Florida delegation. And sponsoring bills, introducing legislation, is one of the most basic things that our legislators do. He was also the 6th most absent in votes compared to reps serving 10 plus years. And this is what it got him. Daniel Webster ranked the least effective Florida member of Congress. He's received about $2 million in salary as a member of Congress. And in turn, he seems to do as little as possible. In his career, Daniel Webster has sponsored 43 bills. So I decided to compare it to some other local representatives. Gus Bilirakis, who represents District 12, in that same time period, he introduced 192. I will be fair to him and say that he was actually elected for 2 Congresses prior to that, so he had 4 additional years. So when you take those into consideration, his career total is actually 249. But when you compare it to Michael Watts, who is in the 6th district, which is actually my district, he's only served 3 Congresses. He has a career total of 61 compared to Daniel Webster's 43. So when you compare it to other Republican representatives in nearby districts, the numbers don't lie. Our current Congress, he has 0 laws enacted, 0 bills out of committee, and 0 with a companion bill in the Senate. In his entire career in Congress, he has enacted 1 piece of legislation, and that was back in August 2018. So for his $2 million in salary, he has 1 bill to show for it. Gus Bilirakis had 18. Michael Waltz, who's only served in 3 Congresses, already has 3. Talking to Republicans, this is the information that gets them out of anything else, is his record. And even if he tries to defend himself with the nonsense or the fake news claims, I've only compared him to other Republicans in neighboring districts, but when compared to the entire House of Representatives, the numbers just don't lie. The last 118th Congress, he was ranked 409th out of 441 members. 2022, the 117th Congress, he was ranked 428 out of 453 members. His best showing was his very first Congress, where he was ranked 189th out of 450. From January 2011 to December 2023, he missed 432 votes out of 8,021, which equals 5.4%. The median record of currently serving representatives is 1.9%. So this is considered much higher. Okay, looking to 2024, District 11 is not even considered anywhere near a competitive race. It's basically been counted out. Right now, I'm the only Democrat in the race. I hope it stays that way. It is considered a solid, safe Republican seat with no chance of being flipped. Webster and Sabatini are seeing this as a primary race. Whoever wins the primary wins the seat. I'm not an expert, but I do have some hope that we can actually flip the seat. These figures are based on the Cook Political Report, They analyze how partisan a district is compared to the rest of the nation as a whole, and they give it a score. So Cook PVI score of R+14, which is Waltz's district, means that the 2016 and 2022 presidential elections, that district performed an average of 14 points more Republican than the nation did as a whole. District 11 is an R+8. If you look on the other, on the right-hand side, the likely Republicans, those two districts are considered competitive districts, an R+11 and an R+6. The district has drastically changed. Moving more in a position that could help us. Although, let's face it, redistricting, being controlled by Republicans in our House, it's gonna favor them no matter what. But I do think that us moving more towards Orlando, it considers Disney, it carries Disney property, Winter Garden, Windermere, Ocoee, Apopka, parts of going into Orlando. I believe that this year's election will be very important. Unfortunately, I believe that many have left District 11 to a foregone conclusion. But I think that it still has some fight left in it. This election, we have the irresponsibility of the right on our side. Their ultra-white, right-wing MAGA crowd, I think, has really not done well for a lot of moderate Republicans and independents in the area. And I believe that a lot of people recognizing the threat to our democracy is going to help us. Women's rights being on the ballot is also definitely going to help us. So if you go to the next slide. These are the fundraising figures for Daniel Webster. It's actually this, if you see down here, this 2010 race against Alan Grayson. We're in the millions. Val Demings, we're in the millions. If you go to last election, Webster spent $777,000. Shantae Munns, $20,000. She raised $20,000. Somebody told me that she didn't campaign. I don't know. I don't know if that's true. But most of his money is being spent in the primary because he views it as whoever wins the primary wins the seat. They're duking it out in the primary right now, and as long as it continues to be no other Democrat in the race, I feel like we can really focus in on the general election, let these two duke it out, and spend all their money. And we can more effectively use any funds that we raise to really reach moderate Republicans who do not want to vote for MAGA and independents, and really get them to the ballot in November. Get them to vote. If you look, and I didn't put it up here, but the numbers, the percentages, Daniel Webster is always in the 60%. The Democrat is always in the 30s. If we can get to even, if we lose the seat, if we can get in the 40s, in 2 years, this is a competitive race. It's gonna get a lot of attention. It's gonna get a lot of focus. So even by showing a really big jump, even getting us into the 40 percentage points, it's gonna be huge. Because even if he survives this election, Daniel Webster's not gonna run again in 2 years. I don't think he will be able to do it. On his record, he's not gonna do anything in the next 2 years if he gets reelected, let's face it. And if Sabatini's elected, I think his crazy will show enough that in 2 years, we could fight it. But I think that that's why this election is so important. Because even if we lose, which I'm gonna fight harder than I've ever fought for anything to not get to that point, but even if we do, there's a benefit with a good showing. So that leads me to my last point, how you can help. Petitions. District 11, I need 5,586. I'm shooting for 6,000, just in case we have some that don't qualify, and I have to have them by March 25th. If I do not get the petitions, the only other way to get on the ballot is by paying the fee, which is just under $11,000. When you consider that the last election, the Democrat candidate only spent and raised $20,000, that's a big chunk of change. That $11,000 really needs to be seen somewhere else that's actually going to benefit the race. So that's why these petitions are so important. So if you can help me with that, I would really appreciate it. Okay, so to end it, there's a video, but we don't play it yet. I'm going to throw it back a little bit to 2020. I, like many of you, was terrified in those days and weeks leading up to the election. All I could think about was my children, their future, and what would happen if we lost the election. This is an ad from Eric Swalwell that year, and every time I see it, even still to this day, I get chills. The first time I saw it, I wept because it reminded me, and it still reminds me to this day, what's at stake, why we must fight, and why we can't give up. So even though this isn't my ad, it's just a little reminder of what we have to do.
Why are so many powerful people trying to make it so difficult for us to vote?
It keeps me awake, the look on your face, the moment you heard the news. You're screaming inside and frozen in time, you did all that you could do. And the big bad man and his big bad clan, their hands are stained with red. Oh, how quickly they forget.
Put it on
here.
It's American flag.
Only the young. Only the young.
You gotta hold on to that for the rest of your life.
Peace. No.
Think about how you would like the world to be for your daughters and granddaughters.
We're gonna be okay. We're gonna be okay. I promise you.
Partisan issues than specifics to the district. But as I told you guys before, I was born and raised here, and this area is so important to me. I'm from Mount Dora, fifth generation on my mom's side, third generation on my father's side. I don't ever want to see anything to this district and the surrounding areas that will drastically affect it negatively. I think that, I didn't touch on it today, but the right has really been focusing on immigration. It's a huge issue at the border, but I think in the process of pointing out an area that really needs work, they have really isolated a group of people that is incredibly important to District 11. Immigrants are a huge part of our workforce that depends on agriculture, depends on them, and they've really pushed and ostracized them and criminalized them to a point that we really have to protect that group of people that are here, that are working, that are benefiting our communities. And the only thing that they're doing is marginalizing them more. I know a lot of you see what DeSantis is doing with a place like Disney, that all for political revenge, in my opinion, in a lot of people's opinion. They say that they are focused on the economy, focusing on helping corporations, capitalism, everything. But how dependent is this area on Disney, on tourism? And this district, especially including places like Claremont, like Winter Garden, huge Disney workforce, huge. And I think that these policies, which Sabatini's, which Webster obviously agree with, are detrimental to District 11 specifically.
First of all, let me thank Brandy for sharing you. You are dynamic and I think you're going to succeed.
I like to tell people, you know, Sabatini says that he's not a career politician. And I say, when you've only ever held public office or campaigned for public office, you're a career politician. I am not a politician. I am so uncomfortable in this position, but to me, I'm willing to suffer through any discomfort I feel because I feel like the action is worth it. So thank you for saying that.
I think we can all relate to you. I'm a mother of a disabled son. He's 50 years old. Just recently, here in November, Florida officials that are responsible for providing services to people with lifelong disabilities have allowed $800 million that were available to the state and also matching funds from the federal government. They've let it slip through the cracks over the last 2 years, which affects the support that these individuals being disabled need to live in their homes or to live in an assisted living facility. $800 million gone. Are we able to retrieve it? We don't know. We as advocates for the disabled are fighting to find us out. But you, as a mother, can relate to our distress. And advocacy is so important.
I think what DeSantis forgets is that's our money. Tax money is our money. So he's really turning away the money that we've put into the system. And it's supposed to benefit us, all for political purposes. It's ridiculous to me.
Can you comment on how significant do you think down ballot voting is going to be going one way or the other?
Huge. mean, I think that, again, like I said, it being a presidential year, election year, for it being having women's rights, hopefully on the ballot, if they don't manage to do whatever they're trying to do, I think that down ballot is going to be really play a major role. It's going to help people like me. But I think that we have a lot of Floridians who are unhappy about a lot of things. Property insurance is probably the major one right now. And I just keep reminding people that you can't blame Democrats when they haven't had control of the state in 20 plus years. So if you want to change something, you have to change the way you vote. The only way to do it. So I think that our message is going to be incredibly important this year.
Thank you very much, Barbie. Thank you for that very informative, albeit a long presentation. Nonetheless, first of all, you are preaching to the choir here in this room. What I would like to know is, have you thought about making this presentation, a very informative presentation, to the Republican club here in the villages? And I think that would be very, very important. Have you thought about that? And number two, do you have a campaign manager that can help you and push you on to some kind of victory?
So that second part, I do not have a campaign manager. I tell people, you've heard of grassroots campaigns, whatever is below that, that's me right now. I do not have a trust fund. I do not have a huge bank account where I can put my own money into this, but I'm willing to do whatever it takes to get there. My husband and I, we own a small business here in the area, and we work really hard. So I don't have those things yet, but I'm going to get them because it's important to me to have the proper people behind me because I've never done this before. So if you guys have any suggestions or recommendations, please email me. And as far as the Republicans, I'm not scared of them. I'll do anything I have to do. If they'll have me, I'll be there.
You need to talk to them. Believe me, you need to talk to these people.
I'm willing to.
Go for it.
Okay, sorry. 50-50.